evening. I'm Ed Murrow. The name of the program is Person to Person. Tonight we'll be visiting first with actress Carol Baker and her family here in New York. Then we'll be going out to Chicago and the home of gospel singer Mahalia Jackson. We'll be ready to go in exactly 30 seconds.
The name of the sponsor is Life Magazine. People have fun around the world, and you're in on all of it in Life Magazine. This week, Life shows you how the natives of Ceylon have fun in brilliant color pictures. Shows you Dick Powell and Van Johnson brightening up a kid's party in Hollywood. Fun in Miami, where showgirls share a queen-size bubble bath. And fun during a Vanguard launching celebration at Cape Canaveral. Only Life lets you share so much fun every week. Read Life. Now back to Edward R. Murrow.
About 2 years ago, Carol Baker was described as the movie's best new dramatic actress. One critic wrote, "She is an unknown, 22-year-old, gravely sweet, and happily married to a budding movie and theater director." Since then, Carol Baker has been seen on movie screens in Giant and in Baby Doll. She certainly is no longer an unknown. And she is still happily married, 3 years next week, to Jack Garfine, a native of Czechoslovakia, who has directed End as a Man on the Broadway stage and the movie version of The Strange One. Carol grew up in Greensburg, Pennsylvania, moved to St. Petersburg, Florida, became a dancer, and then she came to New York. Carol Baker, Jack Garfine, and their two small children live in this apartment house on Central Park West here in New York City. They moved in a few months ago. Good evening, Carol.
Good evening, Ed.
Well, it would appear that Miss Baker, actress, is occupied tonight being Mrs. Garfine, mother. Is that right?
Yes, and that takes quite a bit of time.
What are you doing, cleaning shoes?
Yes.
Well, I hope that both your youngsters are asleep and that we haven't disturbed them.
No, I don't think so. Herschel David is 9 weeks old, and he's in the back nursery. And Blanche Joy, who's 15 months old, is in the next room, and if we disturb her, you'll hear her.
Do you have any pictures of the children?
I'm sorry, we have no still shots. Jack has taken thousands of feet of movie film on Blanche, but I think it'll take him another year to have it edited.
Well, he's not working on that tonight, is he?
No, he's sitting in the living room. Won't you come and meet him?
Thank you. Evening, Jack.
Hello, Ed.
Carol was just telling me you shot a bit of film on Blanche. Is your son too young to be exposed to your lens, or is it that he just can't take your direction yet?
Well, you know, Ed, it's really a terrible thing, I have to admit it, but somehow with a first child, you're so fascinated and interested, and you take a lot of pictures of them, and then with the second one, you just get a little...
Oh, we only have one reel of poor Herschel.
Get lazy and all that.
Jack, I know you didn't come to America until after the war. How and where did you and Carol meet?
We met at the Actor's Studio. I was up one day, I was sitting at the desk, I took the secretary's place.
And I came in for an audition, and there he was. However, March 1st, 1954 stands out in my mind as one of the most important dates in my life, because on that day I had my first acting class with Lee Strasberg, and that evening I had my first date with Jack, and from that time on all the nice things in my life happened to me.
Carol, why was your acceptance at Actor's Studio so important to you?
Well, the only way I can put it briefly is to say that Lee Strasberg is a man who has devoted his entire life to the study of the theater, and he freely gives this to his students so that he saves you anywhere from 10 to 15 years
of
work.
That's right.
Jack, yes. Having observed Carol's career with Actor's Studio and in your own capacity as a stage and movie director, what's your estimate of the contribution the studio has made?
Well, again, I'll try to be brief about it because we don't have, you know, the time to really go into a big discussion about the studio. But it's amazing that the studio is really a fantastic, potent force. And today it has caused discussions pro and con in this country, in Europe, and all over the world. And yet, Ed, there are only 75 members, active members in the Actor's Studio. And to think that a small group of people like that were able to create this kind of discussion is quite a credit to our own country. And, of course, the main function of the studio today in America is because we don't have a permanent theater or a national theater, is that you produce a play, or rather I'd say you write and direct a play almost to get into the theater. And after you're through with that play, you're out of the theater. The studio fulfills a function by giving you laboratory conditions so that you always feel part of the theater and you can work between plays and develop as an artist. Isn't that what you'd say about, mm-hmm. just briefly, is actually the function of the studio?
Mm-hmm. Carol, I once read someplace that before you came to New York, you made your living as a magician in Florida. Is that true?
Yes, I did work for a time as a lady magician.
Well, have you retained any of those skills?
let me see. I'll show you. You see, if you take a little object like this.
Isn't that terrible?
Wait a minute. Let's try it once
well,
more.
Well, that's why.
Could we try it once more?
All right. So you take a little object and you. Well, at any rate, that's why I quit. You see, I wasn't really very good.
Jack, would you cast Carol as a magician if you had a part open?
I don't know about that, whether I would do it or not, but Ed, we went up for a weekend to Grossinger's a couple of weeks ago, and there was a magic act, and Carol just spoiled the whole act for me. During the whole act, she was whispering in my ear, telling me what the magician was doing, how he was doing it, and there was no magic act anymore.
Carol, for a girl who wanted to be a dancer, how did you ever get sidetracked into the magic business?
Well, I was dancing at some of the Florida conventions, and they have quite a thing about crowning young girls queens.
Yes.
And sometimes I would be the only young girl at one of these conventions, so I would be crowned queen. I was Miss Fireman's Dream and
Miss Citrus Queen.
Yes, and then one time I was crowned the queen of the International Brotherhood of Magicians, and from there I got interested in magic. And after all, there's so much magic to the theater that I feel it was a wonderful step.
Well, it's a long way from being queen of the conventions in Florida to being a movie star and a housewife, isn't it?
Yes, and fixing up a house seems to be quite a task. We've been in here a couple months. This wall is something I'd like to show you. It's one of the things we recently completed and did ourselves. It's a special texture.
I've never seen anything quite like it. How's it done?
Oh, I can't tell you that. If you ask me any secrets about acting, I'll tell you, because I have more where that came from. But this is a secret that we got from our woodworker, Nikoshima, and it's the only secret that I know.
Uh-huh.
I'd like to show you, though, the rest of the house, if you want to come with me.
Thank you.
Oh. Well, this is a mess.
What are you going to make of it, finally, Carol?
This eventually will be the dining room, but we've stored everything in here that we haven't found room for yet.
Is this your next big project, then, in the house?
I suppose so. Oh, my. I even have things like awards here, which I'm very proud of, that I haven't had time to put up, but that'll be my next project, as you say.
Well, you're not planning to put them in the dining room, are you?
No, I've taken over part of Jack's study for some of my things.
That always happens, doesn't it?
Yes. This is an award which I'm particularly fond of. It was given to me by the Hasty Pudding Club of Harvard University, not for Actress of the Year, but for Woman of the Year. And this was the Academy nomination last year. This is the Look Award, and this award was from the Foreign Press.
Jack, yes. Have you reserved at least one spot on the wall, or will it all go to Carol?
Well, as much as I love her, she can't have all the walls. I just am going to keep part of them for myself.
And Jack, what are those pictures I see on the wall behind you there?
Well, this is a picture of my father, and this is a picture of my mother.
Are they in this country, too?
No, Ed. We were all in a concentration camp together, and they were killed. Also, my young sister, who was 8, unfortunately, I've looked everywhere for a picture of her, and I haven't been able to find one.
How did you manage to survive, Jack?
Well, there are so many things. I guess I'd just say good fortune or luck. I couldn't put it on any one thing.
What do you mean by luck?
Well, many people have said, you know, have tried to find answers and say it was courage, adaptability of physical condition. It's true I was 14 years old at the time. But still, I would say that every one of those things was important in certain situations, but overall, you couldn't really say that they were. For example, I was part of a transport of 612 children, and one day that were, you know, going to the crematorium, and one day an assessment came around, and he picked out three, because he had three sick people that he put in the transport. And he looked at one boy and he said, "You out," and he looked at the second one and he said, "You out," and then he looked at me and he said, "You out." Now what would you say? Would you say that it's good, you know, what is it? It's not adaptability, it's something. I mean, it's all things, and yet I couldn't really put my finger on it. But anyway, 1946, I finally came to this country, and it's been quite a marvelous and wonderful experience for me.
I think a lot of us have forgotten much too quickly about those concentration camps.
Yes, Ed, as a matter of fact, I think we have in this country. I think that there have, in other countries, like I hear there's a memorial now in Paris erected to these people, which is a moving one and a touching one. We don't have anything like that in this country, and I hope that we will.
Jack, for one who has spent more than half his years in Czechoslovakia, your command of English is excellent. Did you study it as a child?
No, Ed. As a matter of fact, the only thing I could say when I first came to this country was, "American soldiers, very good. White bread, please." But I guess, you know, one thing I did, I always met people, and I, whatever opportunity I had to travel, I traveled and went around the country and found things like this paperweight here. You wouldn't really guess what this is, would you, Ed?
No, I wouldn't.
Well, you see, there's a little hole here. And when I was down in Mississippi, I picked this up. And what they do, I was in a Negro gambling place, and they put this down on the gambling table. And to avoid cheating, they make you put the dice through this little hole, and there are two little shoelaces in here,
yes.
You see? And the dice have to turn over. And so you can't cheat.
Very good idea. Carol, did you do a lot of shopping in Mississippi when you were down there on location?
No, I didn't have time to do any shopping, but I'd like to show you some sketches that I have. It was very, very cold in Mississippi that time of year. As a matter of fact, it was freezing, and the picture was supposed to take place in warm weather.
Yes.
So an artist from New York, Alec Kanarek, came down to do some sketches, and this is what he found, us all huddled up in a loft on top of that big house. Here's all the actors. You can see how we're bundled up.
Yes. Carol, what's your next big movie project?
Oh, well, I have a movie which I think is going to be very exciting. It's called The Big Country, and it was directed by William Wyler. It should be out this summer. And then Jack and I have a project which we'd like to do jointly.
What's
actually,
that?
Well, it's a book that both of us bought together, our first property that we really acquired
yes.
together and we plan to work on.
Is that what you hope to do ultimately in the theater?
No, I don't want to say that.
What's the long-range plan?
I think, really, our dream is to someday have a little theater of our own.
You know, at a place where, well, we could do plays that are challenging to our talents, that would help us develop, and also somehow get young people involved in it, and maybe out of a little theater like that, where young, new playwrights, new actors, new directors can come into, maybe something unique can come out of it, which would also be unique for our country.
Well, much luck to both of you. I hope you bring it off. Thank you very much, Carol. Thank you, Jack, for letting us come.
Thank you, Ed.
Good night.
Good night.
In just a moment, we'll take you for a visit with gospel singer Mahalia Jackson.
That used to be me. I'm Sam Levinson, ex-school teacher. I was at a PTA meeting only last night, but one enthusiastic parent got up and said, "Long live the teachers." And the teacher's voice from the back said, "On what?" Well, teachers have a lot of real problems, and you'll never see them more clearly than you do in Life magazine this week. And I know you parents, too. I'm one of you. And I know you never see much of your kids' teachers, and the reason for that? Life's great pictures show you the teachers just don't have the time. They're just too busy teaching. Did you say something about spare time? Are you kidding? Check Life. Teachers don't have spare time. They use it to make extra money so they can afford to go on teaching your nice kids. This high school teacher drives a bus on weekends. And when his daytime classes end, he has to teach night school. You really get to know this fellow in Life's pictures. He's got four kids himself. And that bare room Life shows them playing in is not the basement. No, that's the living room. Donald Pearson, Master of Science, cannot yet afford to buy furniture for his living room. But he has his rewards. When he sees that wonderful light dawn on the student's face, and know she's really got the idea, finally. Now, will you please read this Life article? It's important. It concerns you. Only Life can show you a teacher's problems and rewards so vividly. Read it. Life magazine, this week.
Now back to Edward R. Murrow.
The voice of gospel singer Mahalia Jackson has been described by music critics in many ways, all of them flattering. But Sister Mahalia, as she frequently is called, says she simply sings the way she feels, and most of the time she feels good. This is apparent to the millions who have heard her, in person, through her records, on radio and television, both in this country and in Europe. Mahalia Jackson comes from New Orleans, where her father was a laborer during the week and a preacher on Sundays. There were six children in the family, and all had to go to work at an early age. While still in her teens, Mahalia moved to Chicago, and she's been there ever since. Mahalia Jackson lives in this red brick ranch house on the far south side of town. That is, when she's not on tour, which is about 50% of the time. Good evening, Miss Jackson.
Good evening, Mr. Murr.
How are you?
Oh, I'm just fine.
You must feel good to spend a little time at home now and then, just taking it easy.
Yes, it really does. And I'm here for just a few days, and I've been here trying to arrange some new songs for my tour that I'm planning to go back on. I'm going back to Kansas City and through Missouri, St. Louis, and a little town in Nashville, in Tennessee, and then Ohio, New York, and Philadelphia.
You didn't by any chance time your homecoming so you could take in the Robinson-Basilio fight, did you?
No, not exactly, but I'm glad he won. But you know, I don't usually like fights, Mr. Murrow.
Well, I can understand that, but what do you like to do when you have a few spare moments to yourself? Read, go to the movies, watch television? What?
Well, I love to watch television, but I can't go to the movies. But you know, Mr. Murr, I have so much to do because, you know, I do most of my own work. And when I do have a little time at home, I'm cleaning and cooking and fixing things. And there's always something left that I should do.
Tell me.
And that's where I take my time up.
Do you sing while you work around the house?
Yes, Mr. Murr, I really do. You know, I find that in the early days, long time ago, during the Depression, when things was very, very hard with me, I find that a song in your heart will help to carry the burdens of the day.
That must have been a rather rough period for you during the Depression and so forth. Did singing help keep up your morale?
It certainly did, Mr. Murr. It done an awful lot for me.
Mahalia, you've given countless people much pleasure through your singing of the gospel. I imagine when you're home, you're constantly being asked to sing by your friends, aren't you?
Yes, Mr. Murr. There's always a lot of people to come and listen when I'm at home. And today, the streets have been just crowded, and there's been so many people. They had to get the policemen to keep the people out because of this great program. But, you know, I take the pleasure of inviting some of my neighbors and my neighbor's children to come in and be on this program with us, Mr. Murrow.
Good.
And these are the young children, but I do hope that you will be glad to meet them and to see my neighbor's children.
Oh, what a fine-looking group.
Now, this is all of the young people here. Some of the names I have forgotten, but here they are.
Could I join them while they listen to you sing?
Oh, yes.
Good.
I'm going to sing a little song for them. They crucified my Lord, and he never said a mumbling word. They crucified my Lord, and he never said a mumbling word. They crucified my Lord, and he never said a mumbling word. And the Lord will bear my spirit free. He rose. He rose from
Oh, that was beautiful. Thank you so much.
Oh, I'm so glad you enjoyed it, Mr. Merrill.
Now I guess the children can eat while I chat a bit more with Miss Jackson. It's been very nice to meet all of you. Good night, children.
Thank you, Mr. Merrill.
Good night.
And now we're going to have you to sit right here while I continue with Mr. Merrill, darling.
Miss Jackson, how did you happen to become a gospel singer instead of, say, a blues singer?
Well, Mr. Merrill, I was brought up in a religious home. All of my environments, all of my life has been in the gospel. And that's why I'm a gospel singer, and the older I get, the more it's a part of me. I can't help from being a gospel singer because I love the gospel.
Well, what essentially distinguishes a gospel song from a spiritual?
Well, the way that I would explain it, Mr. Merrill, is that the Negro spiritual tells of the trials and tribulation that they have had in this world. And that's the difference in a spiritual. But the gospel is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it brings glad tidings to all nations. That's the difference in a Negro spiritual and a gospel song.
Well, you have both great belief and great faith. What was the strongest test it was ever put to?
Well, I remember when I was some years ago during the Depression, when things was pretty hard, Mr. Merrill. And my husband was out of work, and I was out of work, and things was pretty tight. And I heard about this contest going on, the Hot Makata. So I said, well, maybe I'd go down and try to get on. And I won this contest, and the people was glad that I had won it. But I was sad. I was sad. I didn't want it because I had made a promise to God, a personal promise to God, that I would never sing in a theater. And here I had won this great contest, and out of work and everything, looked like I would be, but I was sad. But when I, on the way home, I began to pray and ask the Lord to guide me and direct me. And when I got home, my husband had just a little job of selling insurance. But you know, I was so happy about that, Mr. Murray, because I wouldn't have to sing in the theater.
I understand. But you have done some movie work, haven't you?
Oh, yes. I was in this picture, the St. Louis Blues. The late Dr. W.C. Handy that just passed?
Yes.
This morning.
We had the very good fortune once of visiting him.
Yes.
And certainly with his death today, we've lost a fine artist and a very fine gentleman.
That's right, Mr. Merrill. Well, Mr. Handy not only gave the blues to America, but Mr. Handy wrote some great, beautiful spiritual hymns. And that's the part in the picture that I'm playing. I'm playing in the religious scene. I'm singing some of the songs that Mr. Handy wrote. I think they're very beautiful.
Mahalia, I suppose you've discovered that fame brings with it some problems, too, your own and others. Isn't that right?
Yes, it does, Mr. Merrill. It brings quite a few problems. You know, the people call me all hours of the night, and they ask me questions. But, you know, I sort of enjoy that because I would rather be a good neighbor than to be a great artist. And, of course, when I have my problems, my personal problems, I can find it here before the throne of God when I meditate before him. And this is my meditation room where I meet and talk with the Lord, Mr. Merrill.
Mm-hmm. Well, Miss Jackson, this would seem an appropriate time to ask what your particular favorite is in that vast repertory of gospel songs.
Well, Mr. Merrill, I have many songs. When I meet the burdens of the day, I sing the song that fit the condition of what I'm going through in. But I have a song here that I'd like for you to hear, and it's one of my late records. He's got the whole world in his hand.
Oh, that's my favorite.
Well, I got to start this now. He's got the little bit of baby in his hands. He's got the little bit of baby
In his hands he's got the little bit of baby. In his hands he's got the whole wide world in his hands. He's got a you and me, brother. In his hands he's got you and me, sister. In his hands he's got you and me, brother. In his hands he's got the whole wide world in his hands. He's got the whole world here.
Thank you very much, Mahalia Jackson. Thank you very much. Tell me, other than gospels, what sort of music do you enjoy listening to?
Well, I have a deep sense of appreciation, Mr. Merle, and I love all types of music.
Well, does this include rock and roll?
Well, yes, I like rock and roll. It might be a little loud and overemphasized, but I like it.
Well, Miss Jackson, now that the worst is behind you, the mistakes and the frustrations, looking back, what would you say is the best advice anyone ever gave you?
Well, my aunt, on my mother's side, when I was a girl, I wanted to go to a school dance, and I had a very beautiful dress, and she came up to me and she said, are you going to wear that dress to the dance? And so I said, yes. She said, well, you should wear that one to church. And I said, oh, my, I said, a dress like this is too pretty to go to church in. You know, I thought you just could go to church in most anything. And she said, she told me, she said, always give the Lord the best that you have. And she said, seek ye the kingdom of heaven and his righteousness, and all things shall be added unto you. And, Mr. Murr, I have found that to be true.
I'm sure you have. For things have worked out very well for you, haven't they?
Yes, Mr. Merle, it has. The Lord has been good to me. It may not look like much to other people, but what he has done for me. If you knew from whence I came, you could bear witness that I feel and tell the truth what the Lord has done for me. And I'm so grateful.
Thank you very much, and we're grateful to you for letting us come and visit you tonight, Mahalia Jackson.
Thank you, Mr. Merle.
Thank you very much, and much luck on your concert tour.
Thank you.
Good night.
Good night.
We'll be back in a moment.
A few minutes ago, Sam Levinson told you about this week's installment in Life's Education Series. Now, in connection with this series, you'll find a challenging editorial in Life on the deeper problem in education. Already, Life has received requests for thousands of reprints from school board members, PTA authorities, and universities. If you would like free reprints for use in your community, write to Life, 9 Rockefeller Plaza, New York 20, New York. That's Life, 9 Rockefeller Plaza, New York 20, New York. Now back to Ed Murrow.
Next week, we'll be going to California for a visit with singer Anna Maria Alberghetti and her family. We'll also be dropping in on that man of many talents, author, publisher, and television personality, Bennett Cerf, and his family at home here in New York. There are some of the people who made tonight's program possible. And now, from person to person, good night and good luck.
Easter time is flower time. Your nearby FTD florist will quickly wire beautiful Easter plants and flowers to your friends and loved ones anywhere. There's a wide selection to choose from.
And so inexpensive, too. Why, for as low as $5, you can buy a lovely Easter lily plant. Or perhaps you'd like to wire something like azaleas or cut flowers for Easter.
Phone or visit your FTD florist. He's listed in the yellow pages. Satisfaction guaranteed.